Okay, this is the NCCC compliance project funded by the Innovation Instruction Technology Grants through Open SUNY, or through SUNY, I should say. And this particular one is going to be on making PowerPoints compliant. And this is the third in our series, and you can see by the list that we have three more to go after this. Okay. All right. Some of the stuff, if you've seen any of the other videos, PowerPoint has an accessibility checker just like you have in Microsoft Word. And underneath your file menu in your information area, you have the option to go in and check for issues. And what we're going to be talking about are some of the common issues that are going to pop up when you have content within PowerPoint. All right, so I will be putting this PowerPoint along with the slides out on our blog. Okay. Now, just like any other text within any documents, you have to be concerned with what fonts you use and the font sizes. And in PowerPoint, you actually want to keep your font size no smaller than size 16, okay? And that will make a difference also if you're doing a presentation and it's going to be projected up on an overhead. It's always a good idea to check your font sizes based on the size of the room. And basically, if you keep your fonts at least 16, you should be okay. But you know, double check where you're going to be doing your presentations, because that will make a difference. Okay, we have the same thing that we had in the Word documents, that you should be using sans serif fonts like Arial, Tahoma, and Calibri, as opposed to what used to be our common ones, the Times New Roman, the Baskerville, and the Book Antiqua. Now, I did show an example here of the red and green. If you have a student that is colorblind, red and green will look the same. Or if you print it out, what you think is accented does not accent as well, especially red. This red text is a little bit lighter gray, so it doesn't show up as an accent to somebody who's colorblind or if they have to print out the slides. So that's something you have to worry about with students that are colorblind. Okay, and also remember that you want to make your slides user-friendly through universal design. So using too much color can be an issue with different learning abilities, different learning issues. So keep that in mind if you go in and put too many colors on a slide. Okay. All right. Just like in your other documents, avoid using red and green. Avoid using blue text, because blue text are usually used for links. Don't use underline. Unless it's a link, because students, when they go to look at a document or a PowerPoint, if they see an underline, they assume it's a link. And if you're going to accent in color, you really should accent in color and make it bold as well. So those are the same things that you had in all your other documents, whether it be Word or PowerPoint or a PDF. Okay. Also keep in mind that you should always print out your documents and on a black and white printer, so you can see if the colors are being lost or the accents are no longer there when it prints in black and white. Okay. All right. Now, specific to PowerPoint, your outline view. It's always a good idea to look at your outline view at your slides to see if the text that you want to use and be represented on each slide is actually showing in the outline view. If it's not, often the screen reader will not read that text. So it's always important to go in and check that outline view and make sure it's there. Now, if you have graphics, if there's a very detailed graphics, you should have it with alt text on it for one thing, or put something in the notes section on a slide as well to describe what that picture or diagram is. So that's another thing that if you have text not showing up in the outline view about an object, you've got to make sure that you document that on the slide so the screen readers will read that through the alt text. Okay, or like I said, something in a notes area as well. Make sure that all your slides have a unique title. Screen readers will go through and read the slides by title. So if you have a bunch of slides with the same title, it doesn't make it very descriptive to the screen readers or the person who's trying to have the screen readers read the information. So that's another thing to make sure of. The screen readers can skim through the slide titles. So it just makes it easier for them to review the information if they want to go back to a specific slide if they know the slide title. Okay, so that's another thing. And on my diagram here, if you go into the View tab and Outline View, that's how you will be able to see the text that shows up on each slide. Now, I will say something. If you have publisher content and you've grabbed slides from them, PowerPoint slides, often they will just use a blank slide and just add pictures and text boxes and things like that. That makes it totally un-ADA compliant. So it's very important to make sure that you can see the text in the outline view, okay, that you want the screen readers to read. Okay. The other thing you want to be concerned with is your slide layouts. Now, if you go to the Home tab and go to Layout, there are, I think there's like 12 different options of different slide layouts that you can have. It's always recommended that you use a layout that will cover all the material on each slide. So for an example, if you have a slide that's going to have a title, text, and an image, you would want to use a layout that shows placeholders for all three of those. This way, when the screen readers go through and read the slide, it grabs each piece in each object on that slide and reads that information. If it's an image, you've got to make sure you add alt text so the screen reader will read the alt text that goes with it. Okay, so it's very important to make sure that you have the placeholders. If you use a blank slide or even a slide that has like a title and one placeholder, and then you add an image that doesn't have a placeholder with it, the screen readers might not read it. Okay, so it's very important to make sure that you use the right layouts. Okay, and you want to avoid using blank slides and just adding images or text boxes to that those blank slides. And again, that's an area where some of the publisher content uses that. And then when you go to the view and go to outline view, you're not seeing anything on any of the slides in a lot of cases. So you want to be very careful of that. Okay. All right, and as always, any pictures, charts, links, diagrams, they all require alt text, okay? And anything that, if you right-click on any of those objects, and I can show you the screen here, when you right-click on an image, it's usually format picture. It might say format object. And if you go into the size and properties, you have the option of alt text. I would recommend putting in a title for the actual image and then a description, especially if it's something like a graph. So you want to describe what that graph is showing to students, especially if the screen reader is going to go through and read the alt text on that image. All right, if you use a lot of images that are basically just for enhancement of the slide, that's not recommended. You're better off using something that really means something to that particular slide. And it will make it a lot easier on the screen readers if you don't clutter the slide with a lot of information. Okay. All right. Using tables in PowerPoint. This is actually easier than using a table in Microsoft Word, because when you actually add a table to PowerPoint, it automatically does two things. It puts in the first row as a header row automatically, and that header row is what makes it compliant. So that's automatically set up. You don't have to do it as a header row like you did in Microsoft Word. Okay. They do offer a lot of different styles for the colors on your tables. Just be very careful about the styles that you pick. Even though they're giving you a bunch of styles, doesn't necessarily that they're all ADA compliant. So you want to make sure that if a student was colorblind, that it would be able to distinguish between maybe the header row and the rest of the information. If you use like every other row a different color, sometimes that might be a little bit too much for somebody who has issues with ADA, Lynn, what is the name of that? If a student has an auditory problem, that ADD, attention deficit disorder.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, I mean.
Might have a problem if you add too much detail, too much color to a table. So that might be something.
Even if they have Asperger's or anything like that too.
Right. So the detail, the better you are on your tables. So if you use like the grid lines and maybe color just the heading and leave the rest of the table, sometimes I find that like doing gray every other line is easier to read, especially if it's a large table. This way students can, you know, keep place within the table easier. But those are my things that I like to see. But, using tables in PowerPoint are not an issue. Okay. The other thing you've got to do is you do have to do alt text on your tables. So if you right click on your, there's like a four prong arrow, or you can go to the edge of the table and go in and format the table and do the alt text. And I think I have that on the next slide, but let me finish what's on here. You don't want to add the heading of the table within the table itself, because what we often do is merge the top row, and that's not recommended. What they recommend in PowerPoint is putting the name of the table as the actual title on the slide, and then the first row should be your headings for each column, okay? They also don't recommend splitting cells. So this is something that's done periodically, where if you want two separate cells within one, you might want to split it. And they say to avoid that because screen readers have a problem when it gets to that. Be careful about leaving blank rows or blank cells. Screen readers can have a problem, and it can assume that it's done reading the table if it hits a blank row or a blank cell. You can change row heights or column widths to make it look like there's more space for like a heading or something like that. So stay away from that. So we talked about the colors and the tables, and try not to use too many colors. I know some of the tables, they have the option like of a black background when white lettering. And that might be okay for doing a presentation on an overhead, but when a student goes to print it out, you might lose the contrast that you wanted to have within that table. So, you know, kind of keep that in mind. All right, this is the alt text area. So if you right click on the four prong arrow, it brings you into the option to format the shape, and you would go to your size and properties again and set up the alt text. Now, tables, hopefully you won't need too much of an explanation for a table. Hopefully the table pretty much speaks for itself. I would recommend going in and running a screen reader on a table and see if it actually does what you think it should be doing. Okay. All right. Another big thing is embedded objects. You can actually embed Word documents, other PowerPoint presentations, videos, charts from like an Excel spreadsheet, things like that, into a PowerPoint presentation. And they actually recommend for ADA compliance to create a link to that object instead of embedding it. So if you're going to put a YouTube video in there, you should actually just create part of your slide as the link to the video. And that way, when they click on it, it takes them out to YouTube and puts them into the video out there. If it's a chart, I would recommend maybe having the chart sitting out in, you could do an image of the chart, but you could actually create a link to that image so that when you click on it, it will actually go out to like a Google Doc with that image in it, or out, it would open up an Excel spreadsheet with that chart in it, things like that. So there's other ways around embedding objects. And one of the reasons why is they say that with screen readers, it makes it hard for students to know that those objects are there. And if it's a link, at least it will link them out to that particular object to work with. So that's what's recommended for any of the embedded objects. Okay. The other thing is it can't be accessible through the keyboard. And you, if you have students that have dexterity problems with their hands and they have to use a joystick or other devices to click on things, they might have a problem clicking on a video to activate it. A link, they could actually go through the keyboard to activate that particular link on that slide. So that's another reason why they don't recommend embedding objects. Okay. File format. You can set it up so that students download a PowerPoint viewer, but they actually recommend offering the PowerPoint as a PDF for students who don't have that as an option on their computer. So I would actually recommend any PowerPoints that you offer in your class, offer them as a PPT, which is a normal PowerPoint extension, or also offer it as a PDF version of the file. Now, I put a lot of text onto my slides in the notes area, and the PDF format doesn't give that to students. So what I did was I exported the PowerPoint into a Word document. There's an option to export in your file format, and it created the notes. So it actually gave each student an image of the slide, and then on the right-hand side, it actually gave them the note text that went along with it. So if you're going to do something like that and put a lot of notes in that you want the students to see, you might want to save it in that file format, and then that can be saved as a PDF through Word. So that's another option. Okay. And this also gives them different file formats to print to make it easier for them. Okay. If you go to PowerPoint and you try to print it out, you do have a lot of different options to print. And if they're not real familiar with PowerPoint, it would make it a little bit harder for them. Okay. All right, so here's our resources that are available. If you have any questions about how to use what we're doing, how to make a PowerPoint, the Buff State is a great option. They have different webinars that are specific to how to make a PowerPoint accessible, how to make a Word document accessible, and a PDF accessible. Okay. Lynn, I know I went through that real fast. Was there any questions that you had as we went through? I could go back slides if you need to.
No, I think this is a good overview with the PowerPoint.
Okay. All right. I know that you had some questions about embedded documents or embedded objects. Did that answer that?
Yeah, that was pretty clear for me. I was just, I was confused with a few things with PowerPoint. So, no, that helped clarify.
Okay. All right. So, I think we're going to make this short, and I'll send out the recording.
Perfect.